Good morning! Welcome to church!
Here's this morning's call to worship.
Psalm 95, 1-3. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving, and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful am my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. My will but thine. He had no tears for his own needs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, sing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall live.
Love. Well, good morning. It's good to be with you this morning. Our Old Testament scripture today is Psalm 1. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. In the New Testament, we turn to 1 Corinthians 15, 12 to 20. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and your faith has been in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it's true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have died in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. And our gospel reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, beginning at verse 17. He came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, and those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cursed. And all in the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out from him and healed all of them. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets." These are the words of the Lord.
Completely to you. So I'll walk upon salvation. Spirit alive in me, my life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do? But I feel in this heart, oh God, completely to you. So what can I say? And what can I do? But I feel this
ahead in our study of the book of James. I'm reading from James 2, 14 to 26. James writes, "What good is it, my brothers," and of course he means brothers and sisters, that's implied, "if someone says he has faith but does not have works, can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Go in peace, be warm and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, 'You have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.' You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, 'Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness,' and he was called a friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. And in the same way, was not Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead." Just outside of Colorado Springs, Colorado, is a mountain called Pikes Peak. I've been there, but just to the base of it. Pikes Peak is one of the highest mountains in the southern part of the Rocky Mountain Range. Its summit is 14,115 feet high. there's actually a road that you can drive up to reach the summit. It's very windy. It takes about 2 hours to get to the top of this winding mountain road. Well, on the way back down, there's a place where the authorities do a brake check. The road is so steep that they want to make sure that people haven't ridden their brakes all the way down the hill so that when they continue, the brakes don't fail. So about halfway down, some authorities take a laser temperature of your brakes to see if they're hot and they're apt to fail. If you have ridden your brakes and they're too hot, you're required to stop for a half hour to let your brakes cool. Everyone thinks their brakes are fine. But we're told that we'd be surprised how many people are pulled over to let their brakes cool down. They were saved by a catastrophe by having their brakes checked. Do you have faith? I think most of us would say, yeah, I have faith. Well, although we think we have faith, it's important to check with God to do it's important to check in with God to do a check to make sure that we truly have faith. And this is what James is doing in this part of his letters. Do you have the kind of faith that is acceptable to God? It's not enough just to think that we have faith. We need to test to determine if we have a valid, real faith. The crux of James's discussion begins in verse 14. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but doesn't have works? Can that faith save him? So here's someone who claims to have faith, but does he really, James is asking. He has faith, but he doesn't have any of the activity that should go along with that faith. James asks a very important question. Can that faith save him? Can this kind of faith be actually a saving faith? So James uses four cases to answer the question. Can faith without any of the corresponding activity save? Can it be a real saving faith? The first case that James uses to illustrate a situation where a brother or sister is poorly clothed or lacking in daily food. That's case number one. This brother or sister is in true need. But rather than doing something, one of us says, go, be warmed, be filled. James is saying, what good is that? It's an example of an empty, worthless faith. Verbal statements are not faith. Only speaking words is not faith. James makes the point that you can say whatever you like, but that's not real faith. And this is really important for us to understand today. You can say that you love Jesus all you want, but your words are not faith. Real faith, James says, leads to action. Real faith doesn't merely say some words and pay lip service to Jesus. In verse 17, James concludes his first case with the point that faith without any action is dead. Faith that does not lead to action is of no benefit. That kind of faith is not a saving faith, but James calls it what it is. It's a dead faith. Well, we have to ask ourselves, how many of us have this kind of dead faith? We say all the right things to people, but we don't lift a finger to show our faith. We say the church is a church of helpers, but someone needs help moving, and we don't lift a finger to help them. We say we are a church of prayers, and we say, oh, I'll pray for you, but we don't really pray. We look like good, faithful Christians by the words that we say, but our lack of action reveals something completely different. What are we doing that shows that we have what James is calling a saving faith? What can we point to in our lives that clearly reveals the faith that God is asking of us? False faith offers no service to others. Here's James's second case. One person says he has faith. Another person says he has works. But here is the challenge. Show me your faith apart from your works. Show me faith with any activity. How can anyone know that you have faith if you don't act on it or show it? James says, I will show you my faith by my actions. Faith is proved by a way of life. I will show you my faith. Do we think of faith in these terms? Do we think about showing our faith, that we need to demonstrate our faith to the world? Faith is something that can be seen. I've used this analogy many times, but every day you and I put our faith in the chair we sit in. And we don't only say that chair can support my weight, but we actually sit. And our action proves that we had faith in that chair. If faith cannot be seen, then it's not saving faith that God calls for. James proves this point with an observation about demons. He says, you believe there is a God? Guess what? The demons also believe there is one God. Even demons have proper beliefs. Even demons believe in that basic doctrine of God. James points out the foolishness of a faith that doesn't act, because even the demons believe and shudder. Their belief at least causes them to shudder. James points out how foolish it is to think that belief alone has some sort of saving value. James calls those kind of people foolish people. He says if we think that faith without activity is useful, that's just foolishness. It's not useful to others, and it's not useful to God. How many people believe that Jesus is the Son of God, but then do nothing with that belief? If all that your faith consists of is logging on to watch the church service, or when we're able to, sitting in the church building, you have a dead faith. It's a useless faith. You don't have real faith if all that your belief does for you is gets you to a weekly church service. James says this faith is not a saving faith. Keith Green made this incredibly funny but really astute statement in a live concert back in the late 70s. It's been used and changed a bunch of times, but here's the original quote that Keith Green said. Going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than going to McDonald's makes you a hamburger. The third case presented is the example of Abraham. Did Abraham have actions behind his faith? The answer is absolutely he did. He showed his faith through the activity of offering up his son Isaac on the altar. Well, rather than reading the account that James is referring to, which is found in Genesis 22, I want to show you a video, a beautiful video, featuring a song written by Andrew Peterson. The song is called Holy is the Lord. The song tells the story.
Wake up, little Isaac. Rub your tired eyes. Go and kiss your mama. We'll be gone a little while. Come and walk beside me. Come and hold your papa's hand. I go to make an altar and to offer up my lamb. I waited on the Lord, and in a waking dream he came. Riding on a wind across the sand, he spoke my name. And here I am, I whispered, and I waited in the dark. And the answer was a sword that came down hard upon my heart. Holy is the Lord, holy is the Lord. And the Lord I will obey. I will follow where you lead. There I'll lay the body of the boy you gave to me. And even though you take him, still I ever will obey. But maker of this mountain, please make another way.
Abraham is told to offer his only son on the altar to God. And of course, this command does not make any sense. But Abraham goes to obey the command without any question or any hesitation. As Abraham is about to kill his son to offer him on the altar, God, through the angel of the Lord, calls out to Abraham to stop and not kill his son. Abraham's faith was revealed through his actions. He was going to offer Isaac, believing that God could raise his son from the dead. He didn't simply believe. His faith led him to action and obedience. Abraham is an example of faith that saves. Abraham's faith is contrasted with the person who says he has faith apart from activity. Abraham was not saved apart from activity. In verse 22, it says, "You see that faith was active along with Abraham's works, and faith was completed by his works." Faith must be active, must be doing something, or it's not a faith that saves. It's completed by our works. Our faith is carried out and revealed by what we do. It's actually sitting in the chair. Words cannot be separated from faith. Activity cannot be removed from belief. Faith and works were cooperating together. The final words in verse 23 always sent a chill down my spine. Abraham is described with an amazing title. It says, Abraham was called a friend of God. Could there be a better description that God could give us? Would there be anything better than hearing that your Lord considers you a friend? Faith that works brings us to that point. Saving faith obeys what God commands, no matter how inconvenient or how difficult. Abraham casts a strong light in our areas where we have dark faith. We often think we have saving faith, but are we willing to obey the commands that we find difficult, inconvenient, or just plain don't like? Well, Abraham was, and James describes saving faith as having a very special faith that obeys God. James concludes his third point, that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. This is the only place in scriptures where the words faith and alone are joined together. We are saved by faith alone if we mean the kind of faith that James is describing. James is describing a saving faith. He's describing faith that isn't merely belief or confession. It's not really something we think or something we say. But when we obey God in our actions, that's a saving faith. And with that faith, we are saved by faith alone. But we're not saved by faith alone if we think that faith is simply believing in God. Even the demons believe in God. And the final case, case number four, that James presents to show that faith without action doesn't save, is the example of Rahab. Rahab was also justified because her faith caused her to act. She hid the spies in threat to her own well-being because it was just plain the right thing to do. True faith does good to others, which ties back into verses 15 to 17. In the first case, the first illustration, James revealed that false, non-saving faith does not act on behalf of others. It says all the right things, but does not help others. In the second case, the second illustration, James showed us that even demons believe, but they don't have a saving faith. The same goes for us. Our belief is not enough. Faith must lead to action in obedience to God. The third case, the third illustration, showed us the faith of Abraham. We learned from Abraham that true faith offers obedience of great sacrifice. Saving faith will make great sacrifices to serve and obey the Lord. And in the final case, the final illustration, James used Rahab to show that saving faith acts godly towards others. Saving faith acts in the best interest of others, even if it's at a detrimental cost to our own selves. I hope you've been as challenged by this message as I was. May we be a people of true saving faith. I shared with you last week that I woke up with the hymn, "He Giveth More Grace," going through my head. Well, it's been rumbling around in my head ever since. Perhaps it's because there's so much space up there. I don't know. I found a beautiful version of that hymn for us as we continue in our worship.
Giveth more grace when the burdens grow greater. He sendeth more strength when the labors increase. To added afflictions, he addeth his mercy. To multiply trials, his multiplied peace. His love has no limits, his grace has no measure, his power has no boundary. Riches in Jesus he giveth and giveth and giveth again. When we have exhausted our store of strength has failed ere the day is half done. When we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's forgiven is only love has no limits, his grace has no measure, his power has no limits. his infinite riches in Jesus. He giveth and giveth and giveth again. His love has no limits, his grace has no measure, his power has no boundary known unto men. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again.
Thank you for worshiping with us. May the love of the Father, the tenderness of the Son, and the presence of the Spirit gladden your heart and bring peace to your soul this day and all days. God bless.